Especially as we try to make sense of a world around us that seems to be falling apart in some places of God's real estate, we certainly want to intercede for others. We want to intercede for others who are not here. We have several people still traveling. It's a vacation time. And I had emails from all over, from the summer, all over the world, in fact. I'm impressed with how much traveling we do. How many like to travel? I mean, many of you do. Yeah. Sometimes some of you travel when you don't like to travel, right, Mark? China and Italy and all those. The sermon, the message is about traveling, and it's about Jacob traveling and what we can learn in the middle of vacation about our travels that I think the text can share something with us. So what I was thinking about was Jacob's traveling to Haran. Bathsheba is very south in Israel, and Haran is very much north, and he's trying to get north. And so the text that I'm reading is very familiar to you because it's Genesis 28, where he has a dream about a ladder. And we've sung that song about Jacob's ladder before. Well, we're going to see what else is in this text that we can apply to our lives in our world these days. So, reading from Genesis 28, starting in verse 10. Yeah, verse 10. Listen to God's word to you. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east and the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go. And I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place. And I was not aware of it. He was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Early the next morning, Jacob took the stone he had placed under his head and set it up as a pillar and poured oil on the top of it. He called that place Bethel. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Lord, we do open your word in community, and we hear these words and contemplate these words and pray that your spirit would help us understand the truth which you would have for us in applying your word in our lives. May the words of my mouth, meditations of our hearts, be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So how many of you are on Facebook? I mean, that's, put them up high. I want to see, because this is really, that's about, that's about 90%. Don't you wish you had a nickel for every dollar of stock in Facebook? So most of you are into social media. Have you been getting those little highlights to do that proliferation of quizzes and questionnaires? You know, the one that says, like, what animal are you most like? And I'm afraid I'm going to be a bull moose or a cheetah or something. And then the one that says, well, which movie star are your characteristics most like? And of course, I would be Robert Redford, R.R., Roger Rabey, Robert Redford. I was thinking some similarity there. Paul Newman would be all right. Some of these old guys, you remember Paul Newman? And then the one that, the newest one, though, that came out last week. Now, it might be old. You never know if you're getting a rerun or something and you missed it before. Which character on the Andy Griffith Show would you be? Did you get that one? So they got pictures there of Andy Griffith and then Barney, Opie, and Gomer Pyle. And I was afraid to take it for fear that I would end up being like Gomer Pyle or Barney. So I just didn't even take that one. But there are all these out there. And the one that I thought was applicable to what we're talking about was this one called Travel List Challenges 100 Places to Visit Before You Die. And I thought you'd be so interested in it that look on the back of your bulletin and it's the website's there. So you can go home and you can compare yourself with everyone else. Isn't that what these things are doing? What you're doing in this kind of this self-indulgent trend is comparing yourself. Well, I went to 27 of the 100. How many did you go to? And then someone comes back and went to 60, and you're thinking, my gosh, what kind of bank account do they have? You know, and it's an interesting scenario of events, but this one, I thought, Highland travels a lot. I had no idea how many people own RVs that go to Highland. How many of you all like to camp? Anyone in this group? Well, good. Noe and Lori, Chris, okay. Got a handful in the other service that raised their hands. But like I said, I just got emails from Puget Sound in Washington and Tuscany, Italy last week from members of the church. So I thought, well, this 100 places to go. And I went in and I did the exercise. I won't tell you how many I got. But it's kind of biased toward America, which is okay. But this is what I want to do. I want us to take this quiz. So I want to see how many of you have been to some of these places, okay? So this is Gettysburg. How many have been to Gettysburg? Okay, we're starting off easy, right? Okay, so we're doing Gettysburg. And then we're doing this, Times Square. Okay, right down the street, right? Times Square. Now you gotta keep a tally in your own head. There's a big door prize at the end. Okay, Washington Monument. Oh yeah, everyone's been watching Monument. Niagara Falls. About 6 hours away, Dee Dee and I first went about 5 years ago, had a great time. This one, Rocky Mountain. Oh, yeah, we're starting to thin down a little bit. You gotta get out to Colorado, folks. It's a great place. South Dakota, Mount Rushmore, still have people. Yosemite. I've not been, I wanna get there soon. Yosemite. Disney World, who hasn't been to Disney World? Has anyone not been to Disney World? Oh yeah, you got a few. Proudly so, right? Yeah, I'm holding out there, Scott. Okay, Hawaii? Okay. Boy, you guys are traveled. All right, here's a good one. White Cliffs of Dover. Okay, we still got hands going up. I couldn't find a place that people hadn't been. I only have a handful up here. Stonehenge? Still got a bunch of hands going up. Leaning Tower of Pisa. How many were there when you still could climb up the stairs? They won't let you do that anymore. It's another like percent over. I mean, it's going to fall. get enough weight up there, and we'll take it down. Okay, here's one. Where's that? Kremlin. Anybody? Kremlin. Okay, got Kremlin back here. Okay, we need Doug Good here, our diver photographer. The Barrier Reef. There. Golly, I tell you what, this is impressive. The Wailing Wall, Jerusalem. All right, I've got my little piece of paper in there somewhere. Great Wall of China. John, is that you? Okay. And Gail Robinson just said, Robinson said they are gonna go there in September. Great Wall of China. I threw this in for Noe. Machu Picchu. You were born near there. There's a little plaque right down there. It says, Noe was here, right? Okay, how about, Mount Fuji. Anyone been to Mount Fuji? You've been to Mount Fuji? Oh my gosh, I can't find anything. Okay, a couple more. Here's one, Taj Mahal. Got Taj Mahal right in the back there. Easter Islands. Okay, looks like a winner. Easter Islands. This group, no, going once? Okay, we had someone in the other service that had been to the Easter Islands. Here's another, Mexico, Chichen Itza.
Close.
You're close. Yeah, I had several people say it's worth a trip, finally. Bora Bora. Anybody? We had someone that had been to Bora Bora in the other service. I couldn't believe that. I mean, all these destinations. You can take that quiz, and it's kind of fun, but it's biased as to what you think is in the top 100. But since I just got back from vacation with Dee Dee, we did some tent camping in Canada at Prince Edward Island in Nova Scotia. The next 30 minutes are my pictures, and I'll have popcorn in the back for everybody. So here's one of the beautiful lighthouses that we had. There's Dee Dee taking a little siesta in the middle of a beautiful garden. We've got, these are the sunrises that we were getting from our tents because we were in the state and provincial parks right on the ocean. It's just absolutely gorgeous. This is the Cabot Trail. Anybody been to Cape Breton up in Nova Scotia? That's a biker's paradise. So I biked up two of these hills, and at one point I wanted to get off the bike and take a picture, but I didn't think I'd be able to keep going because it said 13%, 3 more kilometers. And at the top of that was a moose right next to the road. I did get off my bike for that guy. And that's where you're at Bay of Fundy. Y'all been to Bay of Fundy? The tide's 42 feet difference. So we're walking on the ocean floor right now. And tonight it'll be the highest ever because go out and see the moon tonight. It's the closest it'll be all year. It's called a supermoon. So it appears 13% bigger and 13% brighter. I could read the words on my t-shirt last night in the dark because the moon was so bright. But the tides will be the highest ever at Bay of Fundy, 42 feet difference. So you're on the ground there, and 6 hours later, you're 42 feet high if you want to be on a kayak. It's amazing, and you see all these gorgeous, that's out of our tent. That's up at Meat Cove in Nova Scotia. Whoops, okay, we'll turn that one off. So the idea here is you've got a tremendous number of places to go to. You and I will never, ever get to all those places. We won't even get to probably 50 of those places. But really, is seeing 100 places before you die really that important? That's kind of the question here, doing all these kinds of things. And it's not when you consider that no one particular location in the world is quite as amazing as the God who made that location and the God who says he is present in each of those locations. Jacob certainly wasn't checking Facebook when he was on his way to Haran, given that he needed a place to go to get away from his furious twin brother Esau. Jacob was on the run, and he was trying to get to Haran as fast as his desert camel could take him. You remember Jacob. He's the one who cheated his brother out of his father's birthright and inheritance. And now Jacob is fleeing, going back to Haran, his ancestral home, so that he can take refuge with this extended family and perhaps in that tradition find a wife as well. And Haran was the only place that he was interested in checking off before he died. But what I find intriguing about this story in chapter 28 is, as we often hear, is that it's not about the destination. It's about the journey. And that's what we find out here with Jacob. You see, on the way, Jacob stops at, it said in verse 11, did you catch it? A certain place. Could be any place. It wasn't even a named place at the time. It's no Taj Mahal. It's no nice little cottage in Bora Bora. In fact, it's got no name at all, just some random spot in the Canaanite desert that wouldn't make anybody's top 100. Jacob pulls up and he gets a stone, which he uses as a pillow, very, very different from that real thick air cushion that Dee Dee and I were using and the nice pillow from our bedroom, you know, that we didn't do real serious tent camping, but it was in a tent. He used a stone for a pillow. He beds down for the night, and then he drifts into a dream. Scholars think that what he's talking about here is very similar to this picture of Chechen Itza, where we used to hear that song, Jacob's Ladder, we used to sing it as a child. Well, it's probably more like a ziggurat, which is a pyramid type of a building that he's probably dreaming of right here. When it says, A ladder was set up on the earth, the top of it reaching to the heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending. And so here it's really fascinating that he has this amazing sight, particularly in the middle of this vast desert. Now, the angels don't speak to Jacob, but the text tells us that God stood beside Jacob, and then this narrative takes place. And the narrative is a restatement of the covenant promise that God made with Jacob's grandfather, Abraham. And he's talking about how he promises the numerous offspring of this family, which all the families of the earth will be blessed from. And despite his devious deception and of his brother's birthright, despite Jacob being the younger brother, Jacob was the one who God was going to use to have his redemptive plan for all of creation to continue. But family inheritance, that's kind of in the future. What's interesting in the text is what happened in the present. Because of verse 15, you can see that Jacob took this to heart when it says, "Know that I am with you and will keep you," some texts say, "watch over you, wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I promised you." Jacob wasn't going to be checking off 100 wonders of the world during his travels, but he would have something that every traveler needs, whether we've gone around the world or whether we are homebodies, and that is the understanding that he would be in the very presence of God wherever he is. No matter where he traveled, no matter what dangers awaited in front of him or what dangers were chasing him from behind, God was going to be with Jacob and watch over him. That's what the text shares. So that wherever Jacob was, even in a trackless, faceless, and nameless desert, where a stone makes a good pillow, God was going to be there. And then when Jacob awakes from his dream, the angel staircase is all gone, and all he has left is this stone. But what he does is he takes the stone and pours oil over it to make a ceremony and to make that a site of worship. And it was named Bethel, in Hebrew, house of God. And he says, "Surely, the Lord is in this place, and I didn't even know it." And then later he says, "How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, Bethel, and this is the gate of heaven." It says that Jacob was afraid. Well, that's a natural reaction when you encounter the holy. But he was also overjoyed to realize that what had once been a nowhere place was now a somewhere place because God had been there. Jacob came to understand an important truth that no Facebook questionnaire can ever capture. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter how many of those 100 places you can check off. It only matters that God is with you where you are. It doesn't matter if it's Paris or Philadelphia, if it's the Louvre or Louisville, or if it's Bora Bora or Bucksnort, Tennessee. Every place is sacred. Every place is special. Every place is holy. Because you are there, and God promises to be with you there. Even those places you feel like are trackless spiritual deserts. You see, sometimes it's the apparently God-forsaken places that we experience the holy. Because God's already there, even if we didn't know it. How many of you would put a hospital down in your top 100 of destinations? And yet I have witnessed time and time again the presence of God's Spirit in that hospital room. God is there, even when we don't know it. There are a lot of lonely places you and I find ourselves. Loneliness of grief, loneliness of unemployment, the loneliness of a broken relationship. And like Jacob, we can believe that we're all alone and there's no one to help. But it's in these lonely places that often is where we encounter God, offering his sense of presence in a way that's very special to all of us. We might dream of a vacation, but life often puts us in places where we can't go on vacation because life has made us unable to have immediate gratification from time to time. We're taking care of kids. We're raising rambunctious children. We're caring for aging parents. We got to kind of dig down and bed down for the long haul many times in our lives in an arena that probably sometimes feel like a rock is our pillow. And yet in working diligently and in seeing the smile of special moments on a children's face or seeing that special expression to that parent who doesn't recognize you anymore, we discover to our amazement that God is there with us and strengthens us to go the distance, to persevere. We certainly want to avoid funeral homes on our top 100, but I'll guarantee you'll probably be in a funeral home at some point. It's one of the places that most of us visit when a loved one dies. As soon as we got home from our vacation, we had to get back in the car and go to North Carolina, Greensboro, 7-hour trip, to my favorite aunt, the one that helped make me the person I am. And I wouldn't have missed it for the world. God was in the chapel of the First Presbyterian Church in Greensboro, North Carolina. His presence was affirming the power of the resurrection in that service at a time of death, with all my first and second cousins there. Only two were missing around the whole country. California, Colorado, you name it, everywhere. Any of these places can be a house of God. Any of them can be a gate of heaven. Holy ground is where God stands beside us, reminding us that God will never leave us no matter what circumstance we're in. Every place can be awesome. If we're paying attention, God's presence is right there. I love that quote. I put it on the back of your bulletin, if you'll look at it, by John Muir. Not known for Christian values, but known for being a very spiritual person, this one who began the Sierra Club. Look at that quote. All the wild world is beautiful, and it matters but little where we go, to highlands or lowlands, woods or plains, on the sea or land, or down among the crystals of waves, or high in a balloon in the sky, through all the climates, hot or cold, storms and calms, everywhere and always, we are in God's eternal beauty and love. So universally true is this. The spot where we chance to be always seems to be the best. It's fun to think about traveling to exotic places and seeing the wonders of the world, and we all could use a go-cation to go somewhere when we get a chance. What Jacob reminds us in this scripture text, whether we are vacationing or staycationing, whether it's near or far, or if it's a wonder of the world or 7 miles from nowhere, whether it's at the ends of the earth or the end of your street, it's an awesome place. Because God is there. As an intercessory group of people, as we pray for traveling mercies for one another, may our prayers be for each other. When we arrive to our certain place in our travels, that we will remember what Jacob teaches us this morning, and we will be able to join him in saying, truly, God is in this place. May it be so for each of us. Let's pray. Lord, we are so thankful for Jacob, for his lesson he gives us in how you appeared to him and how you might appear to us, not in the destination we choose, but even in the most unexpected places, the certain places of our lives. We give you thanks for the promise that you will watch over us and that you will keep us by your gracious Spirit. We pray In Jesus' name, amen.